Recorded Books presents The Year of Jubilee by Cindy Morgan, narrated by Sisi Aisha Johnson. This audiobook contains original music by Cindy Morgan. At the end of this program, you'll find an interview with the author. For Samuel Morgan, November 7th, 1966 to October 31st, 1971. The fear of death follows from the fear of life. A man who lives fully is prepared to die at any time. Mark Twain. Prologue. There are some moments in your life you don't forget, even when your eyes grow dim and your skin is thin like a moth's wings. You can find them there, buried deep. You dust them off, and they shine like new again. Even now, in my middle years, I only have to crack open the cover of my red journal, and though the ink is fading, the words remain. I remember. I remember the feeling of my father's rough shirt beneath my bare legs as he lifted me onto his shoulders and up to the window of Isaac's hospital room. I remember the white walls and silver railings along his bed. I remember Rojo in my arms, still, with only the sound of his soft clucking as we peered in through the glass. The crest atop his head as red as blood against the window pane. I remember thinking Isaac looked like a bird in a cloud, covered in a mound of sterile white sheets and blankets. I remember long, clear tubes from a machine feeding liquid life into his tiny bird arm. I remember his lips moving as he looked up at us, and I wondered what he was saying. I remember my mother in her pale blue dress standing beside him, holding his hand with a river of sorrow in her eyes. I remember the sound of my heart beating like a drum in my chest, and the smell of the rain as it held its breath before relenting. I remember how we stood there as it started to rain, afraid of breaking the spell we were in. I remember the rain becoming a flood and our lives getting swept away in it. I remember. 1. Constance. The minute I saw Miss Adams, I was keenly aware of my lingering eighth grade awkwardness. My nails bit down to the quick and my clothing meant for comfort instead of fashion. The other girls in her class were also well turned out in their dresses, makeup, and padded bras. I was still in my training bra and trying to tame the frizz in my bush of curly hair. I had come to her midway through the year, skipping from eighth grade into the ninth at the recommendation of my teacher, who felt I was bored and needed to be challenged. Miss Adams was my new ninth grade English teacher, fresh out of college and new to Jubilee. All anyone knew was that her daddy was a prominent doctor from down in Mississippi. She was exactly what any principal in a small southern town would have prayed for, the quintessential southern woman, real marriage material. Her nails were a soft shade of pink, and her hands, like her figure, were slight and ethereal. When she spoke, her drawl was like sugar rolling off her tongue, the way folks with money from the Deep South speak. Nothing like the jagged edges Kentuckians spit out. Instead of saying mother and father with a strong sound at the end, she said mother and father, and it made you want to crawl up in her lap and purr. I remember one day in class, just as the winter relented and the blossom of spring was in the air, she announced we would be taking a field trip and that all we would need was our imagination and a good pair of walking shoes. This was no problem for me or any of the boys in the class, but some of the girls, like one prissy girl named Emmeline Bluen, had worn their good church shoes to school. "You will have to suffer through or go in your bare feet," Miss Adams told them. Sitting on a large quilt under a magnolia tree behind the school, she read us poetry, asking us to listen with our eyes closed and our hearts open. No teacher in this small hick school had ever taken a class on a nature walk to read poetry. Whether boy or girl, didn't matter. We were all a little in love with her. The world blossomed in color and detail when Miss Adams read literary fiction, poetry, and historical novels. I was never bored like I had been in my other class. She took us on expeditions through time. as she recounted important moments and people. The posters of historical figures on the walls came to life. I could hear their voices speaking through her. We all adored her. That was until the last day of school. We were minutes away from the bell that would take us into summer. Attention, please. Miss Adams stood in the middle of the room, her voice breaking into our restless energy. I noticed that her voice warbled a bit in her throat, and she reached for a small glass from her desk and took a dainty drink of water before proceeding. Before the bell rings, I'd like to read you something to think about over the summer break. Something that seems fitting for the times we are living in. She held up a book for us to see. This is The Winter of Our Discontent by John Steinbeck. She cleared her throat, pressing the book to her chest before holding it out in the front of her to read. I wonder how many people I've looked at all my life and never seen. She raised her head, eyes on us, as the book lay open in her hands. A small murmur of disinterest was rumbling from the boys on the back row. Boys, she said, zeroing in on them. Her icy stare froze their words in their open mouths as she waited for silence. She continued to read. No man really knows about other human beings. The best he can do is to suppose that they are like himself. She let the book close and took a deep breath, her eyes bright and leveled with ours. Most of you realize there is much unrest in the South. There are things changing. School integration is happening all across the country. We don't know if next year this school could possibly embrace the idea of integrating. Eli Gunner shot to his feet. You must be out of your mind if you think that's gonna happen. The boys erupted in laughter. Eli came to school most days smelling as though he had not showered and devoured the warm lunch as if it was his first meal of the day. The stutter he struggled with made me think that God must have had it out for him. Eli, Miss Adams stretched out her hand toward him. I know it might seem unthinkable, but you might have to open your mind to something different than what you've always known. I wondered if all the fantasies the boys had about Miss Adams were shattered in that single moment. In the South, there were two unforgivable sins, speaking poorly of the Holy Spirit and being a liberal. I knew Miss Adams was different, but it wasn't until that moment that I understood how different. Word would get around. Miss Adams clapped her hands three times and we fell quiet. She took a deep breath and pressed her palms together in front of her, as if poised to pray. Emmeline Bluen raised her hand quickly. Yes, Emmeline, she spit out, letting her irritation show. My daddy says it's because of the curse of Ham. You see, when Ham looked on his daddy Noah's nakedness, God cursed him by turning his skin black. All the coloreds are descendants of Ham and are cursed just like he was, and that is why they won't ever be equals to the whites. Miss Adams tipped her head sideways, drilling her gaze into Emmeline's. Starting to speak, her voice caught in her throat and she had a small coughing episode. She reached desperately for the glass again, holding her index finger in the air to ask for a moment, and this time guzzled all of the water before responding. The proper term, Emmeline, is Negroes, not coloreds. No offense to your daddy, but that sounds like a justification to demean an entire race of people and ease his guilt over denying Negroes their constitutional and God-given rights. The room let out a gasp. Emmeline's eyebrows scrunched together and her mouth gaped open. Then she aimed her retaliation. I don't think you know who my daddy... The bell rang. Even with the victory of this scathing last word, the message Miss Adams had hoped to convey had landed like a turd in a punch bowl. Most of the kids scrambled to their feet, leaving Miss Adams and her lofty ideas in the dust behind them. She stood at the classroom door, calling out goodbye, hopeful maybe that someone would look back. No one did. I felt bad for her. I'd started to get up from my desk to go when Eli ran past me and tripped on his untied shoelaces. He fell to the ground and his shirt, which he looked to have outgrown in junior high, slipped halfway up his back, and revealed a purple bruise the size of a man's fist. He reached to shove the shirt back down as he got up, and I looked away so he wouldn't think I'd seen the bruise. "Are you okay, Eli?" Miss Adams asked.
Yes.
And he rose quickly, running out of the room without tying his shoelaces. This left only me and Miss Adams in the room. "Grace, could I see you for a second?" I gathered my things and walked over to her, my hands sweaty from the humidity. She gazed out the door, deep in thought, and then asked me, "What did you think of what Emmeline said?"
"Oh, I've heard that before, but my father thinks it's bad theology."
"Really? And your mother?" I stared at her, unsure of how to even begin to explain the complexities of Virginia's theology. She shook her head from side to side. "It was a shame that our time together in class had to end like that." Her gaze floated around the room, a look of disappointment piercing her eyes with a slash of gray. I longed to say something to make her feel better, but nothing came out. Distracted, she reached into her desk drawer and pulled out a package wrapped in brown paper with a red string tied around it. She presented it to me. I carefully untied the string, and underneath the brown paper was a red journal with the outline of a bird on the cover. I heard a faint crack as I turned to the front page, blank except for what was written there. "Grace, thank you for being such an engaged and curious student. I think life holds many possibilities for you. All the best, Constance Adams." Constance? I rolled her first name around in my mouth like a butterscotch candy. I had never heard such a grand name, and I decided that it suited her perfectly. Then, before I thought better, I wrapped my arms around her waist, smelling the faint whiff of gardenias. She laughed, startled by my affection, and put a gentle hand on my shoulder. "Thank you," the word stuck in my throat.
"I know how much you love reading, and I thought maybe you would enjoy writing down your own thoughts."
"I'm gonna miss you." I surprised myself by saying that out loud.
"I'll miss you too.
I'm sad I only had you for a little while, but I'd love to keep in touch. Let me know how you are."
"Thank you again." I hurried out, turning my face away from her to hide the unwelcome tears that were flooding my eyes. I wiped them away and left out the front door, heading across the parking lot to the small two-lane road that led to town. An uneven patch of ground tripped me up, but I managed to save myself from a nasty fall. Instead of getting up immediately, I sat on the ground, replaying the moment with Miss Adams while I wiped the dirt and gravel from my clothes.
"You all right, Miss Grace?"
I looked up to see Miss Pearl, an older Negro lady who sold peaches out of the back of her truck along the highway across from school.
"Oh, yes! Sorry, Miss Pearl. You caught me daydreaming."
"Daydreaming is good for the mind," she said, pointing her short, dark finger to the side of her head. "Shows you got imagination. Want a free peach?"
I was so thirsty. My mouth watered at the thought of it. I put the journal into my book bag, letting a truck pass, and crossed to her side of the road.
"Thank you, Miss Pearl. You sure it's okay?"
"Yes, child. Take your pick."
I selected one that was ripe and ready for eating.
"Thank you."
"You're welcome, child. You excited for summer?"
"Yes, ma'am."
I smiled. Miss Pearl had a gentleness in her mannerisms, but her eyes glowed with fire. I wiped the trickle of sweat on my forehead with my sleeve.
"It sure is getting hot," I said.
"Oh, that's a fact. I melt down out here, but they say the sweat is good for your health, so I must be real healthy." She laughed, exposing a missing front tooth. She wore an oversized, bright-colored cotton dress to match her colorful personality. The rolls around her middle jiggled and made the dress jump nervously to the rhythm of her laughter. In that moment, I wondered what it would be like to sit in Miss Pearl's warm lap and let her motherly affection engulf me. Motherly affection was in short supply in my life. I shook the thought loose.
"Miss Pearl, do
Do you get hot sitting out here all day?
I reckon I do, child. But Mr. Oak here, he helps me out.
She pointed upward and gently took hold of a leaf from the low-hanging branch she was parked under. A slight breeze caught her dress and the leaves, making them both shiver for a moment. I fought a sudden burst of emotion at her gratitude for the simple gift of a shade tree. I wonder how long I'd been standing here talking. Virginia got upset when I took too long to get home. Thank you for the peach, Miss Pearl.
You welcome, baby. Be careful now. There's some crazy people on this road.
I'm going to take the trail through the woods and wade in the river all the way back to town.
A fine idea. I might dip my toe in the water after the school rush passes. I ran back across the road and headed for the trees.
I took a bite out of the peach. It was sweet and tart and reminded me of the peach preserves Grandma Josie used to slather on the hot biscuits she made. The juice ran down my chin and onto my shirt, but I didn't even care. The real world fell away as I floated into the woods. The long-armed branches reached across to embrace each other. The shimmering leaves gathered into a verdant canopy overhead. The ground was dappled with patches of gold and shadow. The covering ended abruptly, and the blistering afternoon sun raged again. I walked a few short steps to the bank of the river. I imagine Miss Adams would love woods the way I did. She wrote that my life held many possibilities. It made me feel proud, which concerned me. Virginia said that you shouldn't think on compliments long or else they would grow a seed of pride in your heart. You should think of yourself as being of little or no importance to God. Then you would never be tempted to be proud, which to Virginia was a cardinal sin. I allowed myself to hold Miss Adams' words in my heart a few moments longer, taking my chances with God's displeasure toward me. It was, after all, a familiar feeling. I made my way along the edge of the river, peeling off my shoes and socks. My bare feet sizzled as I crept into the icy water, feeling the current rush over my toes. Small crawdads darted away as I got closer. I winced as my tender skin found sharp rocks along the edge of the riverbank where it flowed underneath the bridge connecting to Main Street. It would never do for Virginia to hear that I had been walking around town like a barefoot hillbilly. I hopped from the riverbank to a small patch of grass and lay back on the soft green cushion, seeing a castle and a shark in the clouds before the wind blew them away. Reluctantly, I sat up to put on my shoes and socks and crossed over the bridge toward town. As I turned onto Main Street, I saw two men going into the Green Parrot Cafe. One's face was so black from coal soot, I couldn't make out who it was. The other was a man I knew, Tater Beggins, a pig farmer who made it a normal practice to wear his dirty coveralls into the diner. The smell of cow or pig manure, coal dust, and three-day-old sweat wafting above the scent of burgers and fries was just an everyday occurrence. Jubilee could be charming and even beautiful when the honeysuckle and dogwoods were in bloom. Tidy farms scattered with chickens, pigs, and cows dotted the outskirts of town. But about a half mile from the far end of Main Street was the eyesore, or the crown jewel, depending on how you saw it. KY Coal. Dust billowed from the large heaps of coal, no matter the time of day. Coal was as much a part of living in Kentucky in 1963 as fried chicken, cornbread, and buttermilk. It wasn't just the poor who worked the mines in Jubilee. It was anyone who had no means or desire to go to college or learn a trade or run a business. I looked into the window of the diner as I passed by. I saw Jerry Lawler, who had been a friend of Daddy's since they were kids. Jerry looked up, saw me, and waved. His teeth glistened like pearls against the coal soot that covered his face. Daddy told me that he and Jerry had worked their very first day together in the mines when they were just 16. It was on that first day in the mines that Daddy discovered he had claustrophobia.
Me and Jerry rode an elevator down into the earth, rattling and shaking, dropping deeper and deeper. We were looking at each other. I could tell he was scared like I was. I remember thinking that hell couldn't be much farther down.
Daddy never went back. Jerry had been working there ever since. I kept walking and thinking how glad I was that Daddy wasn't a miner. I had heard too many stories of men dying of black lung. But Daddy said the miners deserved our respect for the courage it takes to ride down that shaft every day. Those black chunks were the fuel of life hauled in by the bucketful for fireplaces and coal stoves. Virginia had begged Daddy to have electric heat installed, but he said it was still too expensive for us. The dust covered everything with a fine black film, no matter how often you dusted. But what I hated the most was the smell. It was in our clean clothes hanging out on the line and in our freshly washed hair. You couldn't get rid of it. But coal was just a part of life. When everyone smells like coal, nobody does, until someone comes along to tell you that you do. There was certainly no need for burning coal in the sweltering heat of summer. I breathed in the wild, new freedom that only the first day of summer could bring. The air was rich with the smell of fried catfish and adventure. It was a magical feeling. I wanted to hold on to it as long as I could, so I was taking my time getting home. I knew that feeling would vanish the moment I stepped into the house. Holding my red journal from Miss Adams against my chest, I knew there was no more stalling. I rounded the corner from town and turned onto my street. 2. Virginia. Before the screen door could slam shut, her voice sliced through me. Grace? I took a deep breath and caught the scent of lilacs and aquanet. The smell of my mother, Virginia. I would never have dared call her by her first name to her face. I was careful not to call her anything to her face but ma'am. Yes, ma'am. No, ma'am. I'd swallow the words of defiance that hovered at the back of my throat as I accepted whatever criticism or order she doled out. But in my thoughts, she was never mother, mama, or mom. She was simply Virginia. At first glance, she was soft like a buttercup, but you only had to scratch the surface of the petal to find cold steel beneath. I feared her and dreaded her, and when I wasn't struggling with my feelings of anger toward her, felt as desperate for her love as a drowning man in need of air. Some days I imagined her greeting me with a hug and the smell of cookies baking in the oven. My daddy told me that there were many times when I was younger that she had done that very thing. That she had been a doting mother, but that she was suffering from what he called the change, on account of Virginia having a hysterectomy last year due to some complications. My mind wandered back to a moment I immediately blocked out. Daddy said the surgery brought on the change a good 15 or 20 years too soon. I had a feeling it was mostly because of me, and the thing that no one ever spoke of. I sometimes dreamed of a different Virginia, maybe from a memory buried deep. But now, in the blistering sun of reality, a feeling of dread greeted me like opening a door to a dark room. No cookies, just lilacs, aquanet, and wrath. That was Virginia. Obviously annoyed by my propensity to get lost in my own head, she repeated the razor-sharp words, but a little louder this time. I asked you, where have you been? If you have made me late Grace Louise Mockingbird, you might as well go get your switch. Virginia followed the tradition in the South of having your child select their own switch. The trick was, if you returned with one that could not punish to satisfaction, the parent would select another that would deliver a greater penalty than originally deserved. To spare the rod was to spoil the child, condemning them to hellfire before the age of accountability. You'll need to look after Isaac until Daddy gets home. Sisi started her summer job at the Triway drive-in today. Sisi, my older sister, was a not-so-sweet 16 with a brand-spanking new driver's license. My daddy liked to say that she kept the roads hot. She somehow managed to escape the worst of the chores. It was plain that Virginia favored her. Or maybe it was just the stark contrast of her anger toward me in comparison. Sisi and I were always messing up the facade Virginia had carefully crafted. The image she hoped to project to those in Jubilee who mattered. I watched Virginia checking herself in the mirror. Her hair fell like waves of molasses, and her eyes were deep brown chocolate drops with thick butterfly lashes that she fluttered mercilessly at Daddy when she wanted something. Aunt June had once said her figure was as shapely as a Coca-Cola bottle. Whenever we went anywhere in town, men took second and third glances. It was easy to feel invisible around her, and most of the time that was just the way I liked it. Today, she was a thing to behold in her Sears catalog dress. It was a mint green A-line, fitted at the bodice and accented by a pink belt that showed off her small waist. She wore stockings with a crisp straight line up the back of her shapely legs, and pink pumps perfectly matched to her belt. The dress had cost Daddy nearly a day's wages, but he knew how much looking nice meant to Virginia, so he indulged her. I wondered if, like me, he longed for the momentary look of approval that ran across her face when you pleased her. Daddy made sure she had all the pretty dresses she needed to feel as though she belonged in proper society, though he always said Virginia could look beautiful in a potato sack. He even put up with her occasional nagging about wanting a bigger house in a nicer neighborhood. But there was a limit to what even he would tolerate. To tell the truth, I lived for the moments when he said no to her because it made me think I wasn't crazy. She wasn't always right, and I wasn't always wrong. Virginia gave her dress one final glance of half-hearted approval and swished through the kitchen door, looking at me suspiciously. I followed her and the dark cloud she kept close by into the kitchen. She drained sweet tea from a small mason jar and turned her attention on me. Grace, how do you become such a mess by the time you get home from school? Look at your pants. How did they get wet? Have you been in the river again? What a mess. And your hair. I looked down at myself, noticing the yellow stain on my blue shirt from spilling mustard at lunch, as well as the peach juice that had dribbled onto my sleeve. Virginia had recently sent away for a copy of Emily Post's Etiquette. At night, she would read it in bed, hair in rollers, and wake the next morning ready to give us all lessons on style, grammar, and dining manners. She had taken to setting a proper table, laying out all the forks and knives and different glasses for milk and juice and coffee, using every dish in the house. I hated this because it was my job to leave the kitchen spotless before I left for school. Virginia walked out of the kitchen and came back a minute later, carrying a hairbrush and a cotton candy pink purse that matched her belt and shoes. "Do you still know how to use one of these?" she said, handing me the brush. "How do you expect to ever get anywhere in the world looking like that?" I half-heartedly brushed my hair, making little or no improvement. She cleaned off the countertop that was already clean and nervously chattered. "I have an SWS meeting. They are voting on the new secretary, and I am one of the nominees. Do you know that the daughter of the president is in your class?" I knew all right. It was Emmeline. Not only was her father the pastor of the largest church in Jubilee, but her mother, Cordelia, was from money and was the apple of Virginia's social-climbing eye. The Southern Women's Society, or SWS for short, was a social club, thinly veiled as an organization that did good deeds for the needy in and around Jubilee. It was mostly tea parties and bake sales. But any woman in Jubilee who considered herself fit for society wanted in. Membership was by invitation only. Like most Southern social clubs, the political views ran to the far right, and if you weren't white and Protestant, you would not be receiving the teal-blue invitation that women in town prayed to see in their mailboxes. Sisi had overheard one of the high school teachers say that Miss Adams had received an invitation, but had turned them down flat. Handing me a recipe and a list of chores, Virginia started back in. I have set out the flour, egg, and buttermilk. Remember, roll the chicken in the buttermilk and egg, then the flour, then the buttermilk, egg, and flour again. When the Crisco is sizzling, put the chicken pieces in the skillet one by one, on medium heat. I tried to take it all in, but her direction started to sound like a stream of noise from a faraway place. I had never been good at processing multiple instructions. The clothes in the basket in the back room need to be hung out on the line, and don't let the chicken burn. I hate the smell of burned food in here. And besides, it's wasteful. Long before the end of her list, the magical feeling I had floated home and was gone like a toy boat down the river. This was my life with Virginia. Every chore I did was a small penance for the great sin I'd committed against her years ago. Would I always be a prisoner to Virginia and her lists? She finished with a short bye, then took off, plowing her pink patent leather heels into the freshly cut grass, looking down at herself to make sure she was presentable for those she feared she would never measure up to. I took a deep breath, feeling relief wash over me as I watched her perfect figure disappear around the corner onto Cherry Street. In her presence, it was hard to hear my own thoughts or even find my own air to breathe. She used up all the oxygen in the room. I stood on the porch, waiting until she was out of sight, and ran to steal a cold Coke from the secret stash Daddy kept in an old cooler in the shed. I plucked the red journal from where I'd hidden it behind the azaleas. If Virginia knew I owned a journal, she would make it her job to find it and read it when I was out of the house. I had to keep it a secret. I traced the deep groove of the blackbird's outline on the cover. I sat and let the porch swing drag my toes along the wooden boards, letting the weight of Virginia's expectations slip off my shoulders. I heard a crack when I opened the journal. I loved that sound. Then I found the page where she had written, "Thank you for being such an engaged and curious student. I think life holds many possibilities for you. All the best, Constance Adams." I read her inscription over and over again, as if trying to absorb her words into my skin. I thought of the eruption in class today. Those boys and Emmeline had been so rude to openly disagree with her. But I knew Miss Adams had pushed the limits on what country folks in Jubilee could tolerate. "Constance," I whispered to myself, feeling smug that not even that prissy Emmeline knew her first name. I considered how different Miss Adams and Virginia were. They were both very beautiful, but Miss Adams was much younger. Miss Adams walked with a perky stride, confidence dripping from every word that poured from her genteel lips. Virginia fussed and bothered over every crooked seam and chipped teacup. Miss Adams was, after all, a working woman, whereas Virginia worked hard to fit in with a crowd of women who depended solely on the provision of their husbands. I looked back down at my journal, turned to the first blank page, and picked up the pen I had found in the kitchen drawer. I wrote, May 29th, 1963, at the top, and sat staring at it. What should I write? I set the journal open beside me on the swing and popped off the top of the Coke bottle, letting the fizz slide down my throat, cold and sweet, enjoying the momentary feeling of freedom and the possibilities of the summer days ahead. 3. Isaac. There were days with Virginia when I wondered if a life on the run might be a better alternative. But I did have a reason to stay. I had Isaac. His walls were a soft blue. Pictures ripped from magazines he'd read were taped around the room. Horses, planets, and mysterious ocean creatures. His cowboy boots were perfectly lined up at the foot of his bed. Little stray shoots of brown hair stuck out from beneath his cowboy sheets and moved to the rhythm of his breathing, I crept in and eased down beside him on the bed. Virginia said he had the stomach bug that had been going around. Hanging over the top of Isaac's bed was a wooden cross he painted at Vacation Bible School last summer. It had a Navajo design, representing our Native American heritage, though our grandfather had been Cherokee. The teacher had scolded Isaac for that, telling him you couldn't mix being an Indian with Jesus. Isaac said it was his cross and he could do what he liked. The little Navajo cross was peaceful against the blue wall. I smoothed the blanket around him, careful not to wake him. He was 7 years old and already in the fourth grade. When he was four, his kindergarten teacher noticed he'd finished his crafts long before the others. She peered over his shoulder and saw Isaac writing his name and creating little math problems to solve. While all the other kindergartners were working on the letters A and B, she saw Isaac reading Clever Polly and the Stupid Wolf to himself. Virginia was called in to meet with the principal, nervous at the thought of embarrassment by yet another Mockingbird child. But to her surprise, the principal explained the observations of the teacher and asked Virginia's permission to have Isaac's IQ tested. When the test came back, he scored 150. They said only one kid in a few thousand had an IQ that high. They moved him into the first grade and then 2 weeks later moved him up again to second grade. Honestly, they didn't know what to do with him. He craved learning and tended to find trouble when he got bored. Reading seemed to be the answer to keep him engaged. As his reading skills advanced, he read library books on just about everything that interested him. Western novels were his favorite, but he also read nonfiction. How car engines run, trains, swimming, horseback riding, and his favorites, space exploration and deep sea diving. The trouble was, he was so small. The bigger boys took great pleasure in picking on him. He stood his ground, doing his best to uphold his budding manhood. We feared he would get hurt, but he didn't seem to mind that. He was, after all, the grandson of Rowdy Mockingbird, who people said was one of the toughest men to breathe air. He died before we were even born. The way he died left a legacy, not only of his toughness, but also of his stubbornness. He died from an arm wrestling match. After beating every local challenger, he took on a man three times his size. After a long battle, the giant man slammed Rowdy's arm down so hard that it broke and forced the bone through his skin. He was too proud to go see a doctor, as much as Grandma Josie begged him. The wound turned gangrene, and then the poison got into his bloodstream. Right before he died, he told Grandma Josie he wanted his ashes to be buried at the base of an oak tree sapling, so that he would eventually be the strongest and tallest man in the hills through the life of that tree. I had visited the tree in Grandma's backyard, and it always made me wish I'd known him. Isaac was small like Rowdy, and Daddy said when he saw Rowdy's baby picture on the mantle at Grandma Josie's house, Isaac was his spitted image. But something happened that would forever change the way those bigger boys saw Isaac. Spring of second grade, his class was offered a reward. If everyone passed the end of the year math test, the class could visit the Carter family farm. When Isaac came home talking about it, Virginia worried since the farm had a swimming hole and Isaac had not done much swimming. Isaac said, "I read a book about it." "Well, reading is different than doing." Isaac considered this, then asked, "What if I went with Daddy and Grace for swimming lessons?" Virginia knew Isaac wasn't one to give up easy, and so she agreed. "If your daddy says you're ready, then I guess you can go." It was a done deal. We both knew Daddy was an excellent swimmer and had taught me and Sisi to swim. Now it was Isaac's turn. The following Saturday, we all headed off to the lake. Daddy was patient with him, like he had been with all of us. By the end of the day, Isaac was swimming like a tadpole. In class, Isaac offered help to anyone who needed it to prepare for the test. Being just a kid himself, he was able to break the problems down in a way that another kid could understand. His small stature made his massive intellect less intimidating. When the day came to take the test, everyone passed. The Carter family had dug out a pond that fed into the river. It was like something out of Milton's Paradise. Trees hung like a wedding arch over the river. Cherry blossoms shimmered in their bright pink jackets, while the butterfly bushes grew wild among the trees and along the riverbank, making the air thick with the sweetness. There was a vine that had wrapped itself up and around to the very top of a giant walnut tree. It was strong enough to hold a good-sized man and hung at the perfect spot where the pond met the river so that you could grab hold of the vine and swing in over the deep part and let go. Isaac had recounted the story so many times, I had my own memory of it. The vine snapped, and Butch Brogan, the largest of the boys that had bullied Isaac, missed the deep part of the pond, hit his head on a rock, and sunk beneath the murky waters. The current moved swiftly and started to drag him away. The dainty teacher and her students stood around while their screams echoed across the water. Then Isaac jumped up and grabbed the piece of vine still hanging down and swung out, plunging under the deep water. Somehow, even with Butch being twice Isaac's size, Isaac wrapped one arm around his body, using the other to swim with perfect technique. Once Isaac reached shallow water, several of the other boys came to help carry Butch to the riverbank. Isaac pumped on Butch's chest a few times and then did the unthinkable. Leaning down, he put his mouth over Butch's and blew into it. This went on until Butch finally coughed out the river water and gasped for air. There was a sense of awe around what Isaac had done. How could someone so small do such a large thing? I asked him how he'd known what to do to save Butch the way he did. He shrugged. I read a book about it. I decided to let him keep sleeping while I hung the clothes on the line and then came back in to batter the chicken. I wondered if Isaac was ever gonna wake up. I crept down the hallway and opened the door to his room again. He was still sleeping. I tiptoed over and sat on the corner of his bed. Then I heard Rojo scratching at the back door. Rojo had arrived on Easter Sunday. Aunt June, who was Daddy's older sister, pulled into our driveway that afternoon as we all sat on the porch digesting our large meal. She got out and immediately pulled a box from the back seat of her car. "Happy Easter," she said, setting the box down on the bottom step of the porch. "Isaac, this is for you." He stood up excited. "What is it, June? What is it?" "Well, aren't you gonna open it and find out?" We could hear something inside, scratching the sides of the cardboard box. When he opened it, there was a small ball of yellow fluffy feathers with a flash of red on its head. It bolted out of the box, but Isaac caught it. Daddy whistled.
"Would you look at that red crest?" "Rojo," he said, rolling his R the way Zorro did in his movies.
"What does that mean?" Isaac asked.
"It's Spanish for red."
"Let's call him that. Let's call him Rojo," Isaac said. And we did. Daddy built a small chicken coop in the back for him, but most of the time he roamed around the yard and did whatever he pleased. He was ornery to everyone except Isaac.
"Roo, roo, roo,"
came the call from the back door. Isaac rolled over in his bed and opened his eyes at the sound, then looked up at me.
"Hey, why are you staring at me?"
he yawned.
"Just bored. How are you feeling?" "I'm all right. Hope I'm not catching."
He said this as he tried to tickle my arms and giggled.
"If you get me sick, I'll kill you. School is finally out."
I stood and danced around the room.
School's out. School's out. Aw, you missed the last day, Isaac. What a shame, he said, smiling. Oh, stop scratching. I'm coming. I'm coming. Then he looked at me. Want a race? He got up and put on some shorts and a t-shirt, and we went outside. I hopped on my bike, and Isaac put Rojo on the back of his red wagon. We raced down the sidewalk in front of the house. I let him win about half the time to keep it interesting. When Rojo's feathers lifted in the wind, he looked almost regal. People slowed down as they drove by, pointing at Rojo riding in the wagon. He was no ordinary rooster. I looked back at Isaac laughing and running. He was my best friend in the whole world, and these days, since moving up a grade, he was my only friend, but he was enough. 4. The Fox and the Deacon. I awoke the next morning to Isaac standing over me this time, smiling, with his small hand on my arm.
Grace! Gracie! You awake?
I forced my eyes to open.
Do I look awake?
Isaac, I wanted to sleep in. I can't believe you woke me up.
Go away.
I buried my face in the covers.
You gotta get up. You gotta see it. Come on, Grace. You're gonna miss it. Get up.
I could smell his little boy morning breath as he leaned in closer.
Okay.
I forced my legs over the side of the bed. I've got to go pee first. He waited outside the bathroom for me.
Hurry, Grace. You're gonna miss it.
As soon as I opened the bathroom door, he grabbed hold of my hand and pulled me down the hallway past the spare room where Aunt June slept whenever she visited. It was also our laundry room and where we stored the canned food. Right past it was the screen door that led to the backyard. We burst through it, but I stopped in my tracks. Rojo was sitting atop what looked like a small dog, except its tail was orange and fluffy. What in the world?
I heard a ruckus and looked out the window and saw Rojo hovering over it.
What is it?
It's a fox.
No way.
Is it dead?
I don't know, Isaac answered, his eyes never leaving Rojo.
But look at him. Standing on top of that fox like he's conquered Mount Everest.
We inched closer until we could see that the fox was still breathing, his orange furry chest moving up and down. Then we saw a little stream of blood on his face. In a flash, he came to and started fidgeting and spinning and putting his paws over his eye that had the blood on it. And then Rojo hopped around and started pecking on his other eye. That's when we noticed the fox's left foot was caught in some barbed wire that had come loose from the fence.
Look at that, Grace. Rojo hugged tight it with barbed wire and then picked his eyes so he couldn't see.
Isaac was staring, amazed at this strange mythical creature of ours. There were moments when Isaac forgot about logic and was like any other kid his age. I surmised that the fox had gotten tangled up in the barbed wire before Rojo found him. But it was much more fun to go along with the way Isaac saw it. Rojo crowed proudly as he stood atop the poor fox. We laughed until we held our sides and water seeped from our eyes. I put my arm around Isaac's shoulders as we walked through the yard, feeling the wet grass between our toes. We found Daddy drinking coffee in the kitchen and told him of Rojo's legendary battle. He went out, chased Rojo away, and tied a strip of an old t-shirt around the fox's mouth to keep him from biting him, then untangled him from the barbed wire and put him into a cardboard box.
He'll easily work that strip off once he's in the box.
Over breakfast, he told us his plan.
I'll carry him to another part of town and set him loose. He'll live, don't worry. They are tough to kill and even tougher to outsmart. You know what they say, you can't outfox a fox. No one except Rojo.
He laughed and blew on his hot coffee.
Isaac threw his head back, laughing to imitate Daddy.
How about you two come help me out at the garage?
Isaac spoke through a yawn.
I think I might play with Rojo for a while, then sleep a little more. But maybe I could get a ride with Sisi to the garage later?
Daddy put his large hand on Isaac's head, feeling for warmth, then ruffled his hair.
You sure you don't want to come, buddy?
Yeah, I'm sure.
Sissy's here and your mama should be home soon from her garden club meeting. I'll call and check on you in a little bit.
I ran to my room and got dressed. Daddy said we'd let the fox go by the riverbank on the way to the garage. We backed out of the driveway in Daddy's blue Volkswagen, listening to the fox scratching against the cardboard box. As we rode through our neighborhood, we saw Mr. Ferris under a large straw hat, deadheading some yellow roses, a chore I guessed Mrs. Ferris had given him. Other folks sat rocking on their porches, reading the paper and enjoying the cool of the early morning. I loved how it felt to be with Daddy. We rode in comfortable silence, each free to breathe our own air. I cranked the window down and stuck my arm out, feeling the air run between my fingers like water, watching Jubilee roll by. Bright pink, wild Alberta roses and purple lilacs lined the street. I lifted my face into the wind and felt the freedom of summer return. Daddy parked on the shoulder of the road where the forest met the river. He set the box on the ground and opened it. The fox took off running and never looked back. He looks happy to be free, I said. Daddy smiled as he watched the fox run into the trees.
That's how God meant him to be.
We pulled into the garage under the sign standing high above his shop, VW Repair. The small gas station that sat two doors down from our garage was brimming over with men leaning on hoods and slapping their knees at a joke somebody told. Others drank coffee from paper cups. They called out warm hellos to my father and waved at me as we made our way inside. People called Daddy the bug doctor. He was the only mechanic for 50 miles who specialized in VWs. Daddy said that his customers were from all different backgrounds. History buffs, college kids, lawyers, professors, musicians. He seemed to take pride in his association with people of higher learning. Some locals said only liberals drove VWs. I wasn't sure what that meant about my father. The mystery of his unconventional ways revealed itself in layers. I dug down, chipping away for clues and uncovering artifacts of his history. Every layer revealed a different color and texture. But he was, by all accounts, superior to any other man I'd ever known. I answered the phone, acting as his secretary. I organized his desk and played with the radio, exploring different stations while he attempted to fix a dark green bug in the garage. It was a good morning until a VW came to a screeching stop out front in a storm of gravel dust, and a tall, hulking figure squirmed from behind the wheel. It was Old Man Drake. He stood and wiped a trickle of sweat from his forehead with a dingy white handkerchief that he pulled from his pants pocket, then slammed the driver's side door as if offering a blow to a disobedient child. I watched him unseen behind the bookshelf beside Daddy's desk. Everyone knew Drake had no time for liberals or VWs. The car belonged to his daughter. He was a good 20 years older than Daddy and was known to have a white sheet and a hood in his closet at home. He also fancied himself a local radio personality, since he paid for an hour of airtime to advertise deals and luxury items from the furniture store he owned, while featuring special musical guests, including his wife, who was quite possibly the worst singer on earth. He walked in through the large bay door that stayed open when the weather was warm. I could tell his deodorant was given out by the sweat rings that had seeped through his brown western shirt. He wore a small bolo tie and dusty cowboy boots with sharp silver points. I got a whiff of body odor and Old Spice cologne, which made me want to vomit.
Hello, John.
Daddy wiped his hands on a rag as he looked around the car to see who it was.
Hello, Drake.
Drake walked with his chest out, which couldn't compete with the round belly suspended over his skinny legs. He walked up to my dad, placing his hand on the top of the car Daddy was working on. He took a cigarette out of a pack in his jacket pocket and lit up.
My daughter's car's been acting up.
He paused to take a long drag off his cigarette, coughing as he exhaled.
The baby's down with the croup. If it were me, I'd sell that hunk of junk and get her a Ford.
He tapped the long worm of ash off the end of his cigarette, tiny sparks flying like fallen stars to the oil-stained concrete floor.
American made is the only way, if you ask me.
Daddy clenched his jaw.
You can leave the keys over on that peg and I'll get to it as soon as I'm done with this one. It might be a while. If you'd like to use the phone to call for a ride, you're welcome to.
I could tell Daddy was hoping he would leave.
Oh, that's all right. I'm in no rush.
Daddy's face registered his annoyance as he returned his attention to the open back hatch to work on the engine. Mr. Drake helped himself to some coffee from an old tin pot and continued to hover over Daddy, as if he planned to advise him on any problem he might see. The radio was reporting news about President Kennedy and his views on integrating schools. Mr. Drake let out a swear word to describe Kennedy that I had heard plenty of times at school.
He's a socialist. Maybe even a communist.
Drake spat out the words like they were bitter in his mouth. Daddy worked silently, not looking up. I assumed that Drake swore freely because he didn't notice me sitting there. I swiveled my chair around to watch him. He looked up at the ceiling of the garage, releasing another tobacco cloud, then blurted out,
I ain't about to share no bathroom or eating place with him. No, sir.
Daddy looked over at me. Our eyes met. He shook his head in disapproval. Drake kept going.
Once we do that, they'll want to marry our women. Then we got all these mixed babies messing up the gene pool. What do they call them? Mulattoes? That's what's coming next. You just watch and see.
I looked at my own skin, much lighter than Daddy's, since Virginia's skin looked like peaches and milk. What was the name for someone like me that was part Cherokee, part Jewish, and part white? Daddy gripped the hatch with his rag and slammed it shut.
Drake, you can either leave the car and get a ride or walk back to town, or you can bring it back some other time, because I'm in no mood to listen to your mouth.
My breath turned to ice in my throat. Drake jutted out his chest and pressed it into Daddy, then backed off smugly, sizing up his opponent like some dirt under his fingernails. Daddy stayed calm.
I should have known with that engine and Jew blood in you that you'd be a Yankee sympathizer. I was hoping you'd come around, John. See it the way we do in the Brotherhood.
I was pretty sure I knew what Brotherhood he was talking about.
Drake, in case you missed it in history class, the Confederacy lost the war. Well, some of us are still holding to the old ways. Just because some people have caved don't mean we all have to.
I have work to do, and I can't do it when you keep running your trap.
Old man Drake and Daddy stood nose to nose. I could barely breathe. Finally, Drake dropped his cigarette and ground it out with his shoe, then aimed a wad of spit on the floor beside Daddy's black work boots. He left a stream of cussing behind him and drove his daughter's car out of there. I was glad to see him go. Unfortunately, I knew I'd be seeing him again come Sunday. He was a deacon at our church. Daddy crouched down eye level to me.
I'm sorry you had to hear that, Grace.
It's okay. But, Daddy,
Miss Adams says that things are changing. Says that there's a good chance schools will integrate next year. Do you think she's right? His face showed a bit of surprise.
Did she say this during class?
Yep. None of the other kids liked it much. He nodded, not surprised by this.
You sure think a lot of Miss Adams, don't you?
I nodded.
Well, she's not wrong. There is a good chance. But Drake and the others like him, they will fight it every inch of the way. It's amazing how his daughter turned out so nice. Goes to show that someone can end up very different than they're raising.
He added,
you can't change who your father is.
He squeezed my shoulders, then walked back over to the engine he'd been working on. It was true. Whenever I saw Drake's daughter, Miss Rachel, at church, her face was warm and open, and you couldn't help but like her right away. I wondered if Miss Rachel felt the same about her father as Virginia did about hers. When I was younger, I would ask Virginia to tell me stories about him, but she always would change the subject. Before long, I stopped asking. Thankfully, my eavesdropping from the hallway filled in the gaps of her mysterious history. Virginia's father, Willie, had come and gone like a bad toothache during her early childhood. Then, when she was around 10 years old, he left for good. Granny Bee and all her kids had worked through the summer months to grow a huge garden and canned everything under the sun. But by winter, supplies got low. Willie sometimes showed up on their doorstep needing a warm place to stay and some food. And Granny Bee always let him in. Maybe hoping this time things would be different. He had a big appetite, so he would dig into seconds before everyone had their first helping. One time they got down to a single jar of green beans and a handful of cornmeal. With 5 mouths to feed, Granny Bee told him to go get a job. He disappeared into the night after everyone had gone to bed. She had to go begging at the welfare office, humiliating for a proud Kentucky woman. To her credit, after that, she kicked him out for good. The only way to receive help was to divorce him, so she did. But being a divorced woman was a disgrace. I tried to imagine how Virginia must have felt with a father who never supported her family, and worse, left them cold and hungry to fend for themselves. Maybe that was why she put so much energy into fitting in with the ladies from SWS, trying to outrun being the girl with no daddy. Swiveling around in my chair, I watched as Daddy hummed along to a song on the radio. God had chosen him to be my father. My heart felt like it would burst. I launched myself out of the chair like a rocket toward him. He caught me in his arms and spun me around, and it was once again a perfect day. 5. Sunday morning. We heard Virginia's voice echoing down the hallway from the kitchen. Sisi, Isaac, Grace, it's time to get up and get ready for church. She sounded almost pleasant. I would have been suspicious of her good mood, except she had shared the reason at the dinner table last night over turnip greens, fried chicken, and cornbread. Cordelia put me in charge of running the bake sale. The proceeds will buy winter coats for the orphans over in Middlesboro. As y'all know, they are announcing the decision for the new secretary this week. I can't help but think she put me in charge because she knows it's gonna be me. Her smile was dazzling. Daddy had reached his hand out to smooth the side of her face and said,
"Of course it will be you."
She called again, but a little louder. "Sisi, Isaac, Grace, come on now. It's time to get ready for church." I could smell bacon frying and fresh biscuits. Virginia was humming a hymn in the kitchen. I wandered down the hall to find Daddy. I opened the kitchen door and saw Virginia all decked out in her yellow chiffon dress with little pearl buttons all around the neckline. "Where's Daddy?" "Now what kind of manners is that, Grace? No, good morning, Mama. Just where's Daddy?" A trace of a hurt ran across her face. I'm sorry. Good morning. Then I waited. She never even looked up. Your daddy's in the backyard reading the paper. I left as quietly as I could and ran down the hallway, out the back screen door, and into the yard. There was Daddy, under the big oak in his rocking chair, with a cup of coffee and the morning paper propped up in front of him. I could see one of the headlines. Willie Mays slams eighth homer. Just beside his chair was a worn black King James Bible his mother had given him when he was baptized. He had told me about his trip to the altar at a mountain revival when he was 13. Even still, Daddy was his own kind of believer. Beside the Bible, Rojo sat quietly as if he was waiting to be read to.
Hey, Gracie.
Daddy put down the paper. I rubbed my eyes and sat on the ground beside his chair, careful not to get too close to Rojo.
Look at old Rojo, waiting for his Sunday morning sermon.
I knew what this meant. It was, as far as I knew, my father's only flaw. Daddy, are you coming to church with us this morning? He took a long drink of coffee, then let out a deep breath.
Gracie, my church is here in the backyard with the Lord among the worms and the birds and Rojo.
He lifted my chin up to look in my eyes and smiled. I knew exactly how he felt. I would have rather mowed the yard with my teeth than go to church and face some of the uppity people at the First Church of Christ of Jubilee. Could I stay home too? I could sit here by Rojo and listen to you read. His smile drooped.
You know how important it is to your mama that you kids attend church.
But she wants you to go too. Why is it different for us than for you?
I'm sorry, Gracie. It's hard to explain.
He leaned over and kissed the top of my head.
You better start getting ready before your mama comes looking for you.
I got up and slumped back into the house. I understood why he didn't want to go, but I wished he would go just the same. Church was so much more bearable with him. I always felt so nervous when Virginia got around people at church. People like Old Man Drake and Cordelia Bluen, who looked down on anyone who wasn't up to their standards. When I was around 10, Virginia told Daddy that it was downright shameful for a woman and her children to attend church alone every Sunday. I heard them arguing in the kitchen from my usual spot in the hall.
Virginia, if we could go to a different church, somewhere I didn't feel so out of place.
But John, it's the nicest church in town.
Virginia, you know what I'm talking about.
John, please, darling, if not for me, do it for the kids. He gave in. That Sunday morning, he led us out at the front door of the church to find a parking spot. He asked Virginia to save him a seat. He'd meet us inside. I wondered why in the world Virginia chose a seat so close to the front. I kept turning around in the pew to watch for him. As he walked in through the double doors, his dark native features stood out in our church like a neon sign. The church grew silent as everyone watched him walk down the aisle. His face flushed and he stared down at the carpet, too embarrassed to look up. I wanted to run to him. Show them how proud I was that he was my father. But I sat there rooted to my pew, betraying the man I loved most. He and Virginia argued about it in the backyard after church. I could hear them through the window of my bedroom. After that, he only came on Easter and Christmas and an occasional potluck Sunday. Like him, I never felt like I belonged. At least, if Daddy came with me, we could feel like outcasts together. But he could make his own choice. Virginia made mine for me. I was going. He wasn't. Sisi, let's go! Virginia's good mood evaporated when Sisi decided to take forever in the bathroom. Isaac and Grace, you two go ahead and get in the back seat. We will not be late. Sisi!
Finally, we were all piled into the car and on our way. I hated Sunday school, but Sisi loved it for reasons of the flesh rather than the spirit. Taylor Bluen, Cordelia's oldest son and Emmeline's big brother, helped out with her class. You never had to twist her arm to go. He had that perfect mixture of bad boy and southern gentleman charm that turned girls to mush. Virginia thought Cordelia was grooming him to be a preacher like his daddy. The reason I hated Sunday school was Emmeline. As if being a bragger and a know-it-all wasn't bad enough, she had humiliated me in class earlier that year when I had first transferred to the 9th grade. I tried not to hate her, but she made it so easy for me. I saw her standing in the doorway of our classroom. She greeted me with her usual warmth. "Hello, Grace. My, my, did you sleep in that dress?" she said, turning her perfect little nose up at me. "Doesn't your mama have an iron?" "Your face needs an iron." The words were out before I could stop them. Something about Emmeline thawed my frozen tongue. She got up close to my face. "Grace! It's not Christian to say such unkind things when I was just trying to help. How do you expect to find a boyfriend looking like that? Since I obviously know how to make a boy notice me and you don't have the first clue." "Fine by me. You can have them." I had witnessed for myself how shamelessly Emmeline gushed and flirted with Douglas Henry and a couple of other decent-looking boys in class. "Well, if you ever want me to give you a makeover, I could give you some tips on how to attract boys." "I bet you could." Her eyes narrowed, her hands squeezing into fists. "So ungrateful! Don't come crying to me when nobody wants you." She stormed to the other side of the room. An afternoon with Emmeline would be an endless opportunity for her to belittle me. She was great at finding your weak point and grinding her elbow into it. I noticed a group of boys surrounding Billy Raines, engrossed in something he was saying. He had been in my 8th grade class and had always been nice. I moved closer so I could hear. He lifted his hand to wave at me and kept talking. "I had to hide until nobody was looking. Then I jumped on right before it took off. Then I jumped off the train over at the old shoe factory at the edge of town." The boys were guffawing with open mouths and giving him high fives, obviously impressed with his story. "That's dangerous. Why in the world would anyone want to hop a train?" I blurted out, not meaning for the thought to reach my lips and fly into the air. They all turned sharply in my direction, annoyed by the intrusion. "That's 'cause you're a girl," one of them said, rolling his eyes at the others. I wanted to crawl under my chair. Billy came to my rescue. "She's right, I guess." Shrugging his shoulders, then beaming a mischievous smile.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.